in Philippians. Philippians 1:12 says, "Now I want you to know, brothers, that what has happened to me has really served to advance the gospel." The Philippians knew exactly what Paul was talking about. They knew what had happened to Paul. Do you know? A lot. Where do we start? In the spring of 58, not 1958, but AD 58, most likely Paul was in the city of Corinth and he was penning his letter to the church in Rome. And that was a congregation that he'd always wanted to visit, but he'd never been able to. He says, "Something always prevented me." And in the introduction to his letter to the Romans, he wrote, "I pray that now, at last, by God's will, the way may be opened for me to come to you." Romans 1:8. He's praying fervently, "God, finally, make a way, open a path that will get me to Rome so I can visit that church." He says he wants to impart some spiritual blessing to them. And God answered that prayer of Paul, but in a way that neither Paul nor his supporters had probably ever dreamed of. Paul had been in Corinth. One of the things he was doing there is he's collecting an offering for a famine in Jerusalem, and he had decided to personally deliver that. He left there. He's headed to Jerusalem. He stops in Philippi, the church that we're studying today. He picks up some more resources. They were a very generous church. He heads off to Jerusalem. He delivers the gift. He meets with the apostles, and everything's going great until God starts to answer his prayer. I'm going to do this very quickly. I think it's important that we know what happened for Paul, but I'm going to try to keep the story brief. If you want the details, my paragraph and a half covers Acts 21 through 28. So here are the high points. A lie about Paul in Jerusalem, a riot in the temple, a Jewish mob trying to beat him to death. They would have been successful had the Roman soldiers that were garrisoned there not intervened. Then the Roman soldiers, they got him in the barracks and they decided, well, let's find out what this guy did by beating him. And he narrowly escaped that because he was a Roman citizen. He was taken to a trial, hearing in front of his Jewish detractors, the people that were against him, the Jewish council. And it says that the centurions had to rescue him again because they believed that Paul was in danger of being ripped apart. That's how wild it got in that day. And after that, there's supposed to be another trial, but they find out that 40 men have sworn not to eat until they assassinate Paul, 40 Jewish zealots. So the commander of the Roman garrison spirits Paul away in the night to the capital city of Caesarea Maritima. His Jewish accusers show up there and they present their case, and Paul presents his. And then he's under house arrest for 2 years. No substantial charges, no more trials. Periodically, the governor sends for him, Felix, just to hear him, but it also says he's trying to appease the Jews, and he's hoping that Paul will give him a bribe. So that's why Paul is stuck there for 2 years. At the end of that, a new governor is appointed and to that region, and Paul gets a second trial. And it looks like they're going to extradite him. They're going to send him back to Jerusalem to stand in front of the Jewish council, and he knows that will be death for him. So to save his own life, Paul says, "I want my case to go before Caesar." That was his right as a Roman citizen, and they had to grant that. So Paul, after 2 years in house arrest, is packed off. He's turned over to the custody of a centurion and sent to Rome. Finally, he's on his way to Rome. Just a little sea voyage that got in his way. Maybe you know that story. Delay. We shouldn't go. It's about winter. And then they get out on the sea because they don't want to They don't want to wait. And 2 weeks at sea without seeing the sun or the moon, in the waves, everything's thrown over the boat. They cut the lifeboats free. The Roman soldiers are trying to desert. And Paul keeps his faith in the midst of all of that. And then finally, they spot an island. They sense they're near an island. They can't even see it. And they're going to run ashore. And then the centurions, his underlings, want to kill everybody on the ship to keep them from escaping, all the prisoners. So Paul's in all of this peril, and miraculously they survive. They end up on the beach, and he starts gathering firewood, and he's bitten by a venomous snake, a deadly snake. And everybody looks at Paul and says, wow, what kind of criminal is he? He escaped the sea only to get bit by this snake, but he lives. And then he spends all winter there while they're waiting to get off the island of Malta. But finally, Rome. He gets to Rome for another 2 years of house arrest, chained day and night to Roman guards. So when Paul said to the Philippians, what has happened to me? That's what had happened to Paul. And he says, it has really served to advance the gospel. Was that really the way that God opened for Paul to Rome? Was that God's answer for Paul to get to Rome? Well, on his journey to Jerusalem, God kept telling Paul, look, there's hardship, beatings, and imprisonment in your future. But Paul had such a sense of God's calling that he just kept going. He went on. He did what he was supposed to do at Jerusalem. But evidently, after his beating and arrest and his trial and all of that, he's wondering, am I really going to survive? And I think we can read between the lines that he is not only questioning his survival, but he's just low. And Acts 23:11 says, the Lord stood near Paul and said, take courage. As you have testified about me in Jerusalem, so you must testify in Rome. So this, the path to Rome, this is God's doing. On this slow, circuitous, long way to Rome, it looked like Paul was stuck. His missionary travels, he'd made several missionary trips throughout all of Asia. He was a traveling evangelist that completely stopped, curtailed. But during this time, God arranged hearings for Paul before his opponents. And because the Romans, they would never have listened to Paul. They probably would have stoned him. But because the Romans were there, they had to listen. God arranged for him to testify before Felix, the governor of all Judea, and his influential Jewish wife. Paul spoke before that second Roman governor, Festus. Then before Agrippa, the king, the Jewish puppet king of all Judea. And it says, Bernice, another influential woman, his wife, and the high-ranking officials and officers and leading men of the city. All the way along of this trip, he had access to Rome's finest, their highest-ranking soldiers. He wasn't just turned over to any guard. He was turned over to a centurion in the Italian regiment. That means somebody that's he's assigned to the capital police. So Paul got to witness to Publius, the ruler of Malta. And finally, Paul ended up to a stream of soldiers that were from the Praetorium in Rome. And I'm going to explain the significance of that in a second. But what do you think Paul was doing during all this delay, during all this time, during his... What do you think Paul was doing? He's preaching the gospel. In fact, when he penned his letter to the Ephesians, he calls himself an ambassador of the gospel in chains. So that's how Paul thinks of himself. I'm in chains? I'm an ambassador of God, an ambassador of Christ in chains. So Paul's normal way of doing ministry was violently interrupted. And I imagine the Philippians, who loved Paul, remember he calls them his partners in the gospel. They had been supporting him all this time. They must have wondered, What are you doing, God? What a waste. You take this effective traveling evangelist and you stick him in a couple of houses for 2 years. He can have visitors, but he can't go out. He can't go to the synagogues and all the villagers, and he can't speak in the public squares where he's been so effective at leading people to Christ. What is this about? But in his captivity, God gave him access to people that he never could have reached any other way. Could this really be God's path that he prepared for Paul to go to Rome? Well, listen to Jesus. Jesus was trying to prepare his apostles, the 12, for what was coming. But think of what Paul's been through. Jesus says, "Be on your guard against men. They will hand you over to the local councils and flog you in their synagogues. On my account, you will be brought before governors and kings as witnesses to them and to the Gentiles. But when they arrest you, do not worry about what you will say or how you will say it. At that time, you will be given what to say, for it will not be you speaking, but the Spirit of your Father speaking through you." Fits Paul's life perfectly. Matthew chapter 10. Paul did witness, and Paul was given words. You can read in Acts some of his just tremendously bold things that he said to these guys. He was talking to Agrippa, and Agrippa says, "Do you think I'm so quickly going to become a follower of Christ?" And Paul says, "Whether quick or slow, I wish that all men were like me, that all men knew Jesus like me, but except for these chains." Paul did witness. Paul was given words, and look where his path took him. This is Philippians 1, 12 and 13. "Now I want you to know, brothers, that what has happened to me has really served to advance the gospel. As a result, it has become clear throughout the whole palace guard and to everyone else that I am in chains for Christ." The reason Paul is saying this is obviously his gospel partners in Philippi needed that reassurance that the gospel was going forward despite his imprisonment, despite his chains. Evidently, that wasn't clear to them. But Paul says it was clear to the entire praetorium. That's the word again, praetorium. My translation says palace guard and everyone else, and that's because that was a huge government palace in Rome. It was the governmental headquarters of Rome. People didn't just work there, they lived there. And it says it's become known throughout that entire organization. This would be like the Pentagon and the White House and the Senate, if you're U.S. citizens. Somebody can tell me what it would be for Canada or Panama. But all of those rolled together, and it says it's become evident throughout that whole place, to everybody in it, that I'm in chains for Christ. That's right. Because of, let me show you how far it went. The last verse of Philippians, last couple of verses, it's just a final goodbye. 4:21, Paul says, "Greet all the saints in Christ Jesus. The brothers who are with me, probably in prison, send greetings. All the saints send you greetings, especially those who belong to Caesar's household." That's astounding. Because of Paul's imprisonment, there are now believers throughout the highest echelons of Roman government. There are even Christians among Nero Caesar's family. If you know anything about Nero, that's truly astounding. Paul prayed this little prayer, "God, would you please open a door for me to go so I can encourage that church in Rome?" And God said, "No, I'm going to take you to the heart of the Roman Empire and give you a hearing at the center of their government." Here's what I hope will come across in this story. Faithfulness to Christ and his message in darkness leads to brilliant outcomes only God could plan. Faithfulness to Christ and his message in dark times leads to brilliant outcomes that only God could plan. I've had a number of conversations lately with people who feel stuck. Life's not going where they expected. It feels like, in fact, the system, like life is actively resisting them. Maybe that's you also. Maybe you've had two burnt-out cars sitting in your driveway since December, and no matter how much time you spend on it, you just can't get things to move. The doors you want open, the doors you want to walk through are closed. Your plans aren't working. There's a deep sense of frustration starting to cloud everything you're doing. And you wonder, why is God allowing this? Look, unless there's some pattern of sloth or sin that's obviously causing your problem, that would be consequences. Unless you're lazy or crazy, and it's obvious to you, stop machinating about what you have or haven't done, and just hunker down and get busy loving Christ, loving His Word, following Christ, being faithful to Christ and His message through this dark time, because He obviously has better plans than what you want. He's got something else in mind. Now, I know we all want the plan. I'm with you. I want the plan. Tell me where this is headed. But when we're stuck, when we can't see through the fog, my experience has been those are the times when Jesus comes very near to me, like He did to Paul. And through His Word and through others, He says, take courage, take courage. You've been testifying about me here. You'll testify for me there, even though you can't see what that will look like, even though you doubt it. You're faithful now. You'll be faithful then as well. Take courage. So here's my counsel. If you're in the midst of clouds and darkness concerning your future, if God, now this is the qualifier again, if God or His Word or His people haven't pointed out anything specific that you need to change, you know, if He's not speaking to you about something you need to change in your life, then be faithful to Christ and His message in this dark time. Right where you are, right where He has you. Faithfulness to Christ and His message in darkness leads to brilliant outcomes that only God could plan. I thought about some ways I've seen that in people's lives. Maybe you have a child or children that you are very concerned about. You know how deeply you love them, and you see them wandering towards the world, deeper and deeper towards sinful patterns, destructive patterns in your life, and you just can't seem to get through to them. They're hardened to the Word of God. I want to offer you some hope from experience. I had the blessing of being the last of five children that my mother raised, and I was quite a bit younger than all of them, so I got to see my mother on her knees for my older siblings. And that's not figuratively. I would come by the bedroom and she would be on her knees praying for my older siblings. And she would have them on the phone, or if they were home, she would keep Christ in front of them. She kept a witness for Jesus Christ in their face. Sometimes gently, sometimes a little bit out there. But she was faithful to Christ and His message in their lives through bad relationships and drugs and all kinds of poor choices. And through a lot of weeping on my mother's part. But I have a picture of her at her 90th and final birthday. One of my brothers was already with the Lord, but the rest of us are gathered around her, and every one of them, every one of my siblings, is walking with Jesus. Take courage. Testify about me in this dark time. You'll testify me about me in the next stage that I take you in life. I know a man who's slowly dying of inoperable cancer. Fervent, faith-filled prayers have been offered, but he's still sick, and nobody knows how long he has. But the people in his life are witnessing the undying hope of Christ in him, the truth of the resurrection in his life. For some, he will be the only person in the office or the treatment room that they have ever encountered who has real hope in the face of death. And they're going to wonder why. Be faithful to Christ even unto death, and he will give you a crown of life. This man is saying to other people who are treating him by his demeanor and his words, essentially what Paul said, "For me to live is Christ, and to die is gain." Be faithful to Christ in his marriage, his message. Be faithful to Christ in his message in this dark time, and trust him for outcomes that you could never imagine. I want to show you a couple of other really awesome things that God did through Paul's faithfulness. Unexpected. Look at verse 14, chapter 1, verse 14 of Philippians. "Because of my chains, most of the brothers in the Lord have been encouraged to speak the word of God more courageously and fearlessly." That can't be right. Wait, maybe I read it wrong. Maybe it said, "In spite of my chains, others have become courageous and fearless." Or maybe it said, "Because of my chains, the brothers have fled for their lives." No, that's how the devil writes the future in our imaginations and our fears. He says things like, "Who would believe in your Jesus if you're struggling that much? Who would want your faith if you don't have it all together?" Now, there's a balance here. We can't go around like, the Christian witness is not going around like the guy in the cartoons that has a cloud following him and it's always raining and lightning on him. That's not a Christian witness. But when we slap on a sappy smile and lie through our teeth by saying, "Everything's fine," we hurt three groups of people. The first person we hurt is ourselves, because we're not allowing ourselves to be connected to the kind of encouragement and love and nourishment that we're supposed to get from the body of Christ. And then we hurt others in the body of Christ because they think they're the only ones putting on the smile and saying they're all right. They look at us and they think we're all fine, and so they don't plug into the encouragement of the body of Christ, and they don't have the blessing of encouraging you. And then finally, the third group that we hurt are unbelievers who don't get to see us loving on one another in the body of Christ. They don't get to see that we are disciples by our love one for another. They don't get to know that we're connected to Jesus because they see this obviously different love. And they don't get to see that Jesus is the source of our joy even when life is hard. Paul said, "Because of my chains, the brothers have been encouraged to speak the word of God more courageously and fearlessly." Why did it work that way? Well, one part of the equation I think is evident is they looked at all this suffering, all these things that looked like they should have shut the gospel down, that they should have silenced Paul's testimony. But instead, they saw that what was happening to Paul was serving to advance, to carry forward, to increase the gospel. Maybe you were uncomfortable with me saying that what Paul went through was God's path for him to Rome. I would say read more of what Paul says about himself. And then I would say, well, here's another way to look at it. Here's another side exposed about what happened to Paul. It says what happened to Paul served to advance the gospel. It served. When there's service, there's a master. Who did all these events serve? The sovereign, reigning, ruling Lord of our today's and tomorrow's, Jesus Christ. That's who they served. They bowed to his will. I think it's ironic. Paul wrote this letter to Rome, and I don't know, you know, maybe, I don't know when it arrived. It probably arrived before Paul, but then Paul shows up as the living example of something he wrote to those Roman Christians. I'm thinking of Romans 8:28. We know that in all things, God works together for the good of those who love him and are called according to his purposes. Paul knew that before he got to Rome. He sure knew it after he got to Rome. And his courageous faithfulness in chains created courageous faithfulness in others, because it was so overwhelmingly evident that God was in control, that God was having his way despite persecution. And that made others brave. They saw that God and his gospel go forward no matter what men tried to throw in its path. They saw the value and the power of the gospel and the power and value of faithfulness in the face of suffering. Paul and his courageousness spawned other courageousness. They saw the results God brought about through his faithfulness to Christ and his message. And then they went out and they got bold in speaking about God. Be faithful to Christ and his message in these dark times, trusting him for outcomes you could never imagine, and others may catch your courage. The final part of this passage is a little tougher because Paul doesn't give us a lot of details. He assumes knowledge that the Philippians have. But these are the verses 15 through 17. It is true that some preach Christ out of envy and rivalry, but others out of goodwill. The latter do so in love, knowing that I am put here for the defense of the gospel. The former preach Christ out of selfish ambition, not sincerely, supposing they can stir up trouble for me while I am in chains. So it's pretty obvious. Some people loved Paul, and they were preaching out of that love, preaching with confidence that his imprisonment was God-ordained in order to advance the gospel. But what about this other group? Preaching the gospel out of envy and rivalry and selfish ambition. Preaching the gospel to stir up trouble for Paul? I mean, how does that work? What's that about? You can find snippets of it all throughout his writings, but Galatians and 1 and 2 Corinthians are probably the most clear. We find out that there were teachers riding on the coattails of Paul. Paul would go establish a church, and another teacher would come along and try to say, well, Paul's not all that. We're better teachers. We're more eloquent. He really doesn't have the authority that he says he has. They put themselves forward as the real deal while diminishing Paul. Second Corinthians, Paul facetiously calls them super apostles. That's how they viewed themselves. They were preaching the gospel, but with false motives. Envy, rivalry, selfish ambition, he says, for greed in other places. And Paul being in prison looked like the perfect opportunity for them to advance their own careers. Now they can go around and say, well, see, we told you Paul wasn't all that. I mean, God wouldn't have put his prime apostle in prison. He wouldn't have done that. So they're stirring up trouble for Paul by preaching the gospel. Isn't that strange? And I love Paul's response. It shows how much he trusted Christ, how much he trusted the sovereign rule of God. Paul says, what does it matter? The important thing is that in every way, this is verse 18, in every way, whether from false motives or true, Christ is preached. And because of this, I rejoice. You're trying to do me harm and you're just spreading the the gospel. And that's what I'm about. You know from your own Bible study that Paul didn't have any trouble taking on false teachers when he needed to. But Paul wasn't into Paul. Paul was into Jesus Christ. And if Christ was preached in every way, even in ways that diminished Paul's importance, he says, what does it matter? Christ is preached. Paul's entire life was about giving top billing to his Savior and his saving message. As long as Christ was proclaimed, Paul didn't have to be number two on the marquee. Some issues in the church would be solved instantly if everyone would just make Jesus the star of their life, the star of the show. Paul had learned to let the main thing, the main man, be the main man, and it wasn't him. And so his final word on all that happened to Paul was, "Because of this, I rejoice." So friends, be faithful to Christ and his message, even if you're in dark times, trusting him for outcomes you could never design. Be spreaders of courage. Keep first things first. And find joy. Let's pray together. Father, I pray that this message, your word, understood through your Spirit, would be salve on the wounds that people have here today, and courage and encouragement for staying the course with Christ, being faithful to him, finding the courage to speak about him, to praise him even in the hard times. And Father, as we live that together, there are some people here who are having a wonderful life right now. Thank you. Praise God. We'll rejoice with them. They'll weep with us. And as we live this out together, as we live life together, help us find courage. Help us to be more bold in our proclamation of Christ. Help a lost world to see that Jesus is our supreme joy. And give us a future we could never imagine. It doesn't mean beautiful and wonderful and no problems, but with impact and worth and joy that we otherwise could not have found. Help us to say, in all of this, we rejoice. We pray it in Jesus' name for his sake and glory, for our good and for the lost. And let his people say, amen.